Welcome to an NC Live Crash Course. This video is a quick introduction to using HeritageQuest at your library. HeritageQuest is a genealogy database that allows you to search through census records, city directories, and more useful sources for building your family tree. To find HeritageQuest, we'll start on the NC Live homepage. If you are accessing our resources remotely, don't forget to log in with your library. The easiest way to find HeritageQuest is using the Browse All Databases link, and then click on H to jump directly to the section. Since HeritageQuest is often used for genealogy research, let's talk first about what patrons need for the best chance at success. When searching for public records, there are three pieces of information that are the most important, and then three more that are great if you have them, but not necessary. The three most important are the first and last name and any alternate spellings, approximate dates, you can use dates within 10 years, and location of the person. Whether the dates and location are for birth, marriage, or death will determine what type of records you will be looking for, but they can all be used to identify a person. The more of each you have, the easier it will be to confirm the person's identity, but any of them will work. The three additional pieces of data you can use are full names, including a maiden name, parents' or siblings' names, and a family history chart. None of these are required, but they can help confirm someone's identity. There can be more people with the same name than you might expect, and the more information you have, the easier it is to be sure of your identification. With this information in hand, let's now take a look at how to use it in HeritageQuest. We're going to start with a brief look at the layout of the homepage before looking at some of the resources and search features. For those patrons who might have used or heard of Ancestry.com, there are some differences to HeritageQuest and its resources. NC Live has a quick reference guide to those differences to help you with questions from patrons. You can find a link for that guide in the description below. At the top of the homepage, there are some page links that will take you directly to the most commonly used public records. We are going to look closer at a couple of those later. As we scroll down, you can see some general pages of search options. If you are looking specifically for very early records, such as Revolutionary War soldiers or Canadian records, those can be useful pages to start with. We'll begin by looking at some of the genealogy research help that HeritageQuest provides. These can be useful to both librarians and patrons, especially when just starting. A good technique to learn is how to create a timeline when you don't know exact dates or only have one date. The Create a Timeline feature takes you through the technique of using one date you know to figure out more. If you or your patron is running into roadblocks, you might try one of the more in-depth guides, such as local census records. Most of these pages are PDF files that can be downloaded for offline reading. Now that you are ready to start searching records, let's look at some of the more popular records and some records that you might not know about. Near the top of the page, you can see the main public records that are most commonly used beyond the census. While most research begins with census records, there is a good resource to check before you dive in, especially for those searching before 1900 in the eastern part of the country, or before the 1950s in the western half. It is a good idea to take a look at the Census Map Guide first. This guide makes sure you are looking in the right place in the census files. As the U.S. population grew, states and counties were added. You can look at each state and check the county name for your date. Looking at a state like Minnesota, there were a lot of changes in the mid-1800s. Let's look at how to search for a census record, and then we'll look at some of the other resources on HeritageQuest. You can see there are search tips if you are just starting on the right. At the top, you can see the option to match all terms exactly. For most searches, it is best to leave this box blank. Transcription errors, misspelled names, and other factors make exact matches difficult and can result in frustration for your patron. In the blanks on the left, you can enter what information you know. Scrolling down, we can see the different options, depending on what information you have about an individual. At the bottom, you can see all the different records HeritageQuest searches. These will change depending on what information is entered into the search boxes, but they show the advantage of using HeritageQuest. Let's enter a person to search for and see how the census records work. We are going to use some of the basic information that is best to have for searching the census: name, birth date or year, and location of birth. For this example, let's enter Elvis Presley, born sometime around 1930 and somewhere in Mississippi. Because we know that he was born in Mississippi, we're going to go with the exact state option. We know he was born sometime around 1930, but not the exact year. That's okay. We can pick the range of years to search, and for this example, we will choose plus or minus 5 years. And for the name, it's better to leave this open because of problems with spelling, transcription, and other issues. So we'll leave this as broad for both first and last name. Here you can see the results of this search. You can also see that the more information you have, the easier it is to identify the exact person you want. Here we can see some of those spelling issues. We'll take a look at what the census records look like, since we know that this is the Elvis Presley we're looking for. On this view, we have a lot of options. You can see our chosen entry is highlighted, so you can find it easily as you zoom in. You can also see the column labels at the top as you zoom in. The rich icon allows you to move the document around to see better, invert the colors, and also print or download the document. This icon gives you the different spellings for the entry, and also where the document comes from. If you hover your cursor over the entry, you will also see the type transcription for the entry, which is very helpful in reading these entries quickly. All of the census records work the same way and allow you to get a lot of information about the individual that you can use to look for other information. Now that we have looked at the census records, let's look at a couple more options that can be especially useful for patrons. Once you have found more specific information from the census, many of these records can be very useful. If you know the city of residence, you can look through the many city directories, for instance. City directories are helpful because they are not handwritten, so they are less prone to errors in spelling. They can also be helpful for finding the locations of important places in a person's life, like their school, church, or place of work. One of the more common records for genealogy searching is military records. You can search early U.S. military records from this page, especially from the Revolutionary and Civil Wars, and the pension and widows records for those wars. When entering information for these searches, don't forget to scroll down to the bottom of the page to find tips for searching these particular records. There are also records that can be helpful to African American and Native American patrons. Census records are not as helpful for these groups, and other records can be more useful. For African Americans looking for records before 1865, wills and probates can provide some information. But one of the best sources for the end of the Civil War is the Freedmen's Bank records. If a patron has a name and location and is fairly sure of the date falling between 1865 and 1874, they may be able to find records in this resource. This is a different resource than the Freedmen's Bureau records, which are available through the National Museum of African American History and Culture's website. Let's enter Frederick Douglass as an example. As you can see, this results page is similar to the census results page. Hover over the view record and you can see how much information can be found in these records. For Native American patrons, one option that might be helpful is the U.S. Indian Census Rolls. These records cover individuals living on reservations between 1885 and 1940, who would not have been listed on the decennial census records. For more information and resources on how to research African American and Native American individuals, there are links in the description below to help get you started. There are also some options for searching international records on HeritageQuest. These can be found at the bottom of the search page. Some countries are represented, but Ancestry.com has the more comprehensive international records. These options may be limited, but keep them in mind. Okay, let's look at a recap of using HeritageQuest. HeritageQuest provides access to a lot of public records in one place. It has helpful tips and suggestions for how to get started and the best ways to use the search tools. Your patron will need to have at least a name, date range, and location of the person, but the more information they have, the easier the search will be. Links to additional HeritageQuest training resources on NC Live can be found in the description below. Thank you for viewing this NC Live crash course. If you're interested in learning more about our resources and skills that are relevant to librarianship, subscribe to the NC Live YouTube channel by clicking on the subscribe button below.